September
fifteenth,
2018. And this is preparation for Ken Hatlelid's memorial. The Eisenhower jacket he could fit into. His entire life.
Christ Jesus, we were baptized.
baptized into his death. We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life with him in a death like his. And so we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We sing hymn 413, Holy, Holy, Holy. First lesson is from Psalm 30. There's an insert in your bulletin with it written out, and the verses that are in bold are for you. I'll read it responsibly. I'll read the first verse, and you the second. So, I will exalt you, O Lord, because you have lifted me up and have not let my enemies triumph over me. Brought me up, O Lord, from the dead. You restored my life as I was going down to the grave.
Sing praise to the Lord, all you faithful. Give thanks to the Lord, remembrance.
God's wrath is short. God's favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping spends the night, but joy comes in the morning. Our second reading is from the fourth chapter of 2 Timothy, where Paul writes, "As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 7th chapter. After Jesus had finished all his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. And a centurion there, who had a slave, whom he valued highly, and who was ill and close to death. And when he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders to him, asking him to come and heal his slave. And when they came to Jesus, they appealed to him earnestly, saying, "He is worthy of having you do this for him, for he loves our people, and it was he who built our synagogue for us." And Jesus went with them. But when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, and therefore I did not presume to come to you. But only speak the word, and let my servant be healed. For I also am a man set under authority, with soldiers under me, and I say to one, 'Go,' and he goes, and to another, 'Come,' and he comes, and to my slave, 'Do this,' and the slave does it." And when Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him, and turning to the crowd that followed him, he said, "I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith." And when those who had been sent returned to the house, they found the slave in good health. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
be to Christ. You may be seated. I would now invite Sheila Gemerson to come forward to read a poem that she wrote.
Sharp as could be, blinds always open, loving to see. People coming and going, seasons changing all year, new neighbors he'd welcome, bringing us cheer. Independent, hardworking, simple in his ways, innovative with new projects, encouraging all of his days. Helped us drill a well and irrigate our yard, picking grapes and canning juice. Yes, it wasn't so hard. "Come on in, sit down, visit a while," he'd say, listening, asking, sharing stories at the end of a long day. Known as the neighborhood mascot and the keeper of our spare key, so trustworthy and dependable, he treated us like family. Picking berries at Mr. Ken's was one of my kids' favorites, or swinging on the patio swing during one of my many visits. Dipping donuts and cider was our Halloween tradition. In his garage, making all feel welcome was his mission. Bringing community together, that was his way. Ken, we will miss you and we'll never be the same.
At this time, if there's anyone else who would like to say a few words about Ken, I'd invite you to come forward at this time.
the street. So speaking of blinds being open, can always check to make sure mom's work. And I come representing my brother and sister. My sister's in Western New York, my brother's in Arizona, although right now they're on a trip together, so they couldn't make it. We moved from Syracuse, New York to Oregon on the Willamette River and got that collected the first night we were here. And originally we had the old farmhouse on Irving Road, the old Metcalf place. We lived there. And just a funny little thing about Frances, I was a teenager, mind you. She would ride by, and with her white hair to a teenager, she looked really old. And so she'd go by on the bicycle, and I just thought that was kind of both sweet and odd. But in the early 80s, my parents moved around the corner. We kids didn't like the idea of the house. They bought the old Baker house, and mom was never content unless a house was remodeled. We knew there'd be a lot of work for dad, and we thought it was too much. It was one of the best choices they ever made in their life. And they were immediately welcomed and became part of the Shirley Street gang. My dad and Ken were good friends, often talking, whatever it was they talked about. And both men, like my dad, Ken was a true gentleman, a kind, compassionate man who lived his faith. When I'd come to visit mom, sometimes he'd come for dinner. Or I'd go across the street and chat. To the almost the very end, when I visited, he remembered my kids. He didn't see my kids that often, but he remembered who they were, what they did, and pretty amazing considering, you know, this is a smattering of people Ken's known over the years. And my sister Charlotte wrote this, that even though I live on the East Coast, I came to know Ken when I visited my parents. After Dad died, I visited more often, and Mom would say, practically the minute I walked in the door, "Can we have Ken over for dinner?" Of course, I said yes. We shared a meal, and he would tell us about his growing up, about riding his horse to school, and sometimes staying in town because of the snow. I felt comfort when I was back home because I knew Ken was keeping an eye on Mom and keeping her, helping her out in many ways. I feel blessed to have known him. I asked my husband, Jack, to describe him in one sentence, and he replied, "He was a kind and humble man." And so my brother is on a trip, and I could not, he's not the best communicator, and I couldn't get hold of him right now. But I do remember things that he said. He spoke often, you know, Ken does, Ken that, and he just shares some things. And he lives in Phoenix, and when he escapes the heat and comes up here for the summer, and he stayed in Springfield, he'd ride his bike over, and they would just back and probably share a beer or two and just enjoy their time, talk about woodworking or whatever. And he dubbed Ken as one of the men of the greatest generation. Because of Ken, we are incredibly grateful because Mom was able to stay in her home, which was, you know, we always joked that if we took her out, it would be dragging her by her heels because she was determined to stay in her home. Because of Ken, she was able to. He checked on her if the blinds weren't, oh, the drapes weren't open. He'd go over and find out why. And he helped with small repairs and emergency. I think she had him on speed dial. We sometimes called him Saint Ken. So now there's no longer reason for me to turn off at Division and take Irving Road to Shirley. And the Madison clan, you know, we kids will miss him very much.
Anyone else would like to come forward?
We can't hear back here.
Anyone else would like to come forward?
I'm sure you'll hear me. I'm Bob Dixon, husband of Marlis Dixon, sister of Frances, wife of Ken. Ken was a gentle man in every manner of means. Everybody was a friend. He enjoyed entertaining those he had known for a great time and those he posted as the member of the neighborhood. He loved to travel. He and Francis started out tent camping and then moved to a trailer or a three-wheeler and then a trailer. They used the trailer to travel everywhere. Late in July, 1st of July, they went north. They came to the Dixons and they enjoyed very much the fireworks display for the 4th of July and the ice cream and cake also. They also used the trailer and traveled to Death Valley and had very many good times down there with other people using the same kind of trailer as they in that area. They also went to Death Valley to enjoy the crowd. As you're well aware, Francis worked on some of the carnival ships, teaching them about games and crafts. Ken was right there as a helping hand each and every time. He built his own house in 1974. He built many friendships along the time with the neighborhood. He is an outstanding individual, and again I say, he was a gentle man, a wonderful man that we had in our presence. Thank you.
I'm Tim Meinzen. I'm a high school teacher, and I've been a member of this congregation since 1986. And of course, I've met Ken and Fran, and that has been one of the great joys of my life. Most of us know Kenny Hatlelid pretty well. He had no secrets. He willingly shared his life. And though he was a man of verbal economy, he was not a mystery. Instead, Kenny was a rock. Now, mind you, Kenny was a thin and wiry rock at 5'9" and 140 pounds. But we're going to celebrate this gem of a man. And so I decided to share his life under certain key words that will describe his character. But before I begin that, I wanted to tell you that I had the distinct pleasure of sharing bits of time with Ken and finding him the most amiable of companions. Ken and his wife, Fran, were a dynamic duo whose good cheer and willingness to pitch in were part of their DNA. Fran and Kenny were DIY, long before DIY became a fad. They loved hospitality. They loved to explore, to have adventures, and perhaps because their lives were shaped amid the stark beauty and the certain hardships of life on North Dakota's prairies. Ken and Fran's skill and their love of people is shared with their kids, Tim and Jan. Both are exceptionally capable. And Jan maintains their open invitation to come over and enjoy. And a few weeks ago, I asked Kenny about Jan, and Kenny was a man of rare compliments. He said, "Jan is a prize, and we all know this is very true." So here are the words I've chosen to describe Ken. Ken was solicitous. Every spring, Ken asked my wife, Lisa, "What are you planting?" And in the fall, he asked, "How is your apple crop?" He and she traded plant starts for jars of grape juice, the same juice that we'll be enjoying after the service in the punch. And the jars with bouquets are gifts from Kenny. Kenny, as we've heard, looked after people and he could help. Oh boy, could he help. He shared materially and with his hands. But Kenny's best gift was his example of generosity and concern. Ken was neighborly, as you've heard. To be Ken's friend or acquaintance, to live near him, was to be invited by his easy hospitality and selfless helping of all who asked. People loved him and trusted him, and he in turn helped them put in wells, built picnic tables, kept their keys, and gave of his time. Kenny's house was open to all comers, especially at Halloween, where we sat around and gorged on donuts, hot cider, and had the kids show off their costumes, and sometimes the adults. Bethel Davis, anyone? In summer, Ken made homemade ice cream, where more than a few of us gained a pound or two. Carol Bowman told me that Kenny insisted that after you died, we continue the ice cream social. And so, we invite all of you to share ice cream as Ken wanted. Kenny was self-sufficient. As you've heard, he built his own home from a magazine plan. He was always fixing problems here at church, and many in our own homes. He was crafty, using scraps of wood to make all kinds of projects. Most spectacularly, he refurbished the Homestead windmill. He rebuilt the Challenger windmill that is pictured in your insert, which now sits on Denny and Faye's farm in Montana. Kenny could do just about anything with wood. If you look in front of you at the small oak hymnal pews, hymnal holders in the pews, not the large one, but the small ones, Kenny made all those. He didn't have a big workshop or the most modern tools, yet he was a wonder with wood. Kenny was tough. He worked all the time. And this was in retirement. Just a scant couple of months before his death, he mowed our large church lawn this spring, as he had done so many times before. And he worked on the John Deere tractor, even though his vision was practically non-existent. And I watched as Kenny felt his way down through his repairs. But he insisted on treating the equipment with great respect. Once, Nate got banned from riding the lawnmower for several months because Kenny caught him driving too fast. You did not want to incur Kenny's displeasure. His toughness probably came from growing up in the Depression-era farmland of North Dakota, where creature comforts were few and winters were bitter. Kenny mentioned or wrote that he was very glad not to know what chill factor was growing up, because January temperatures in the Dakotas regularly sank to 30 below. And he remembered that the water in his home drinking crock froze inside his home, despite being only 8 feet from their lignite coal stove. And on several occasions in school, the ink in the inkwells froze in the high school house. Can you imagine what that's like to go to school when it's below 32 and your ink freezes up? And also, can't even remember when we had to worry about ink. I teach school, and I cannot imagine any of my high school seniors experiencing with such equanimity what Ken did his senior year, where he had to take a room in the city, little tiny town of Columbus, North Dakota, for school. I'm going to read just a segment from his memoir of the time. I was 3 weeks late starting my senior year. Chet Sorley and I had a room at Cliff Greenup's, a couple blocks from school. We did our cooking on a little hot plate. And he cooked for himself at 17, 18. We ate a lot of spaghetti and stewed tomatoes, chicken, canned beef, and eggs. His sister Thelma was teaching school this year, so she loaned me $5 a month for books, etc. And of this, maybe once a month, I'd spent 20 cents for a movie or 25 cents to go to the Saturday night dance. For other entertainment, we'd go to Bud Hempstead's and play Monopoly on Sunday afternoon, or go to someone's room and play cards. There was also ice skating on the creek or the little rink downtown. The skates I had were clamped onto my shoes, and those of you who remember shoes that clamped on your skates, you know that was always an accident waiting to happen. They weren't too good, he said. A friend of his gave him hockey skates after he graduated and went into the Army. He was a couple of years older than I, and I still have these skates. Fran and I skated a lot before and after we married when we lived in Portland. Ken was unflappable. In his memories of World War II, he appreciated that his fellow soldiers never got excited. And in truth, Kenny never got excited. This story illustrates Kenny's take on his combat experience in World War II. He wrote this. He said, The boys of the 82nd Airborne gave us lots of pointers when we arrived in France, and he arrived in France 4 days after the main assault on June 6th. So they arrived in, I think it was June 11th, June 10th, or June 13th. He said the boys of the 82nd gave us lots of pointers like, leave your helmet strap loose because the Germans tighten theirs, so that at distance you can see it. This probably saved me, Kenny wrote the first night. Jim Baker and I were to set up a machine gun 25 yards in front of the 3-inch guns that were set up to be manned all night. The gun commander told me that exactly at 2 a.m. I was to come back and get a relief man. And exactly at 2 a.m. I walked to the center of the road and started back, gently calling the man's name. And when I got to the gun, the guard said, man, you're lucky. I had you in my sights all the way. And if it hadn't been for your helmet strap hanging down, I may have fired. He had not been told that Kenny was coming back. He was a cool-headed logger from Washington, and he didn't get excited. I guess that's why I don't get excited very often. I found out later of several other incidents. Kenny was humble. This cheerful soul never seemed to seek recognition. He turned down chances at a Bronze Star for combat duty because he saw how unfair the process could be. He turned down pay for work completed because he did the work simply to be helpful. And Kenny was graceful. Kenny was an excellent dancer. But in World War II, he wrote that that skill got tested. While waiting for the invasion day to come with his 6th unit, the 607th, he got to have some time R&R. And so he went dancing with English women. He wasn't the only one, there were lots of soldiers who did that. But he said, this is so interesting, he said that they always wanted to dance to the Hokey Pokey. He said it just about ruined his dancing skills. Even more impressive than being graceful, Kenny was grace aware. He told Lisa that he had an angel on his shoulder when recounting the time the 607th was in France at night, and they were hunkered down along a road, and then over the horizon flew this German Junker bomber. A terror for anyone to be on the ground. And it flew low overhead, and then Kenny could see the bomb bay doors opening, bombs ready to drop on him and his men. The German pilot was unsure the dimly lit troops below surrounding Kenny were German or American, and had just one member of Kenny's troop fired at the low-flying bomber, most of them would have been incinerated. And for Kenny, that was grace. For Kenny, the war was also a crucible. He came home with no taste for war or for guns, like my father. Instead, he wanted the normalcy of friends or family, of camping and work. In 1998, I invited Kenny to see the movie Saving Private Ryan with me. I missed my father, also a combat veteran of World War II, and hoped to connect with Kenny. We watched the movie and the reenacted carnage of D-Day, and then Kenny leaned over to me and said, man, I am so glad I was not there on that day. He had almost been shot by a sentry, shelled by his own side, nearly killed by a sniper bullet that clipped his belt loop. And he spent a mortar attack under a jeep with a first star general. His descriptions of war were laced with a sense of the grace he received, not with anger or bitterness towards the enemy, because Ken lived to do the job, then go home, like so many soldiers. Kenny loved God. He loved his church and the people in it. Kenny was not sentimental, but his actions bespoke a grace that reflects God's grace. Kenny was an ordinary man who lived through extraordinary times. But in a real sense, we all know Kenny not as ordinary, but a person we could count on, a person we could trust, a person who will be deeply missed. Kenny was the best of who we are as Americans, as humans. Kenny was a person we all want as a neighbor, a friend, and family. He was a rock, and Kenny was a gift. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. Thanks to Sheila for that wonderful poem and for those who spoke. During the month of August, if there were strangers that were driving down Shirley Street, they might have noticed a house with a lot of cars parked in front of it, at all hours. people coming and going, and they might have wondered, well, I wonder what's going on there. They probably never even considered that in that humble home, people were coming to say goodbye to a great man. Of course, you know that the home I'm speaking of is the home of Kenny. Well, Kenny owned it. That committee in that Shirley Street neighborhood, it was their second home. A place to gather on Halloween for fresh donuts and apple cider, to enjoy a summer afternoon with homemade ice cream. It was where beautiful woodworking projects were completed and the leftover wood shared with others. It was where people might go if they needed advice or help on a project that they were doing for themselves around their homes. You heard that stunning poem by Sheila and the eulogy from Tim, along with the voices of the others this morning, all bearing witness to Kenny's greatness. Jan was kind enough to share with me some of the letters that he received before leaving on the honor flight back in 2013. And they all carried the same thing, thanking Kenny for his service, but also thanking him for his kindness, his thoughtfulness, and his gentleness. You all know, and you've heard again today, the many things that he experienced in his life, things that shaped who he was, the Dust Bowl, the Great Depression, World War II. Well, as you've heard these stories of Kenny, I'm sure it brought some smiles to your heart, and likely some tears to your eyes as well. And I'd like to take those things that we've heard and say a few things now about what they mean in terms of God's moving in Kenny's life and in the wake of Kenny's death. The story that I read for the gospel lesson, the story of Jesus healing the centurion's servant, is not a typical lesson you use at a funeral. But as I was reading through the gospels in terms of looking for what we might use today, I kept coming back to that story and saying, that's Kenny. I said it, and I knew I was right, but I wasn't sure why. I kept thinking about that, praying about that. Finally, the Spirit opened my eyes. Now, I said a couple times already that Kenny was a great man. And it wasn't because he was rich or famous or powerful. Kenny was great because he served as a strong example and a reminder for us of something that I think seems to be disappearing from our culture. Kenny, as did the centurion, had a strong sense of duty, a word we hardly hear anymore. And I believe that that sense of duty arose directly from his faith. Kenny knew that Jesus had died for him and for the world. And he placed hope in that promise. And he knew that in response to that grace, that he had a duty to remain faithful to his baptismal promises, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God, to share in the Lord's Supper, and to serve all people following the example of Jesus. And Kenny did that quietly and humbly, but with a fierce dedication. Kenny is gone from our midst now, physically, but he's there and will be here every time we worship and we look at that hymn board, or we look at this candle stand, or we look at the case out there that holds the memorial book, or so many other things around this place. Kenny will always be here. Now, there are all sorts of theological and philosophical explanations of this concept of duty, and I read some of them, and most of them, I'll tell you, are mind-numbing. And none of them explains a person who carries out his duty as a child of God as well as this quote from the movie Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, which says, it's all about having a little bit of plain, ordinary, everyday kindness and a little looking out for the other fellow too. Or you might prefer how the prophet Micah puts it. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? That's duty. And that was Kenny. A few weeks before his death, I talked with Kenny about his life. And one of the questions that I asked him was, what words of advice would you like to leave for your loved ones to remember you by? And the answer Kenny gave me was, keep calm. And when I asked him to say a little bit more about that, he said, be patient. Take your time. Look at the situation and do what needs to be done. Do your duty. Death always comes as a shock. Even at 98. It doesn't matter how long it's been expected, or how well you prepared for it, or how many times you rehearsed in your mind what that moment might be like, or how much you prepared for its coming. It always comes too soon. It always comes at the wrong time. But death is a fact. It draws us up short. It causes pain and grief and separation and emptiness and heartache. There's an empty spot, a breaking of the family circle. And as we grieve, we recall experiences, and then again we feel the pain that death brings. As we've heard, Kenny was no stranger around tools. He always knew what tool was needed for the job. So what tools do we need in these days to deal with our grief, to ease our pain, to move us into the days ahead? God gave us a word for us. The book of Ecclesiastes tells us that there is a season for everything under heaven, a time to remember, a time to weep, a time to heal. One tool is our memory. We've heard some of those already today, and it's helpful to bring to mind memories of our life with Kenny and to share those common experiences which were meaningful in shaping life, and in which life was made meaningful. The treasure chest of memory is one of God's precious tools to help us grieve. And I invite you to continue sharing memories, especially today as we go in and share some ice cream and cookies in the fellowship hall during the service, after the service. And certainly, this is a time to weep. God has given us the gift of tears, I believe, to help cleanse our spirits. It's been said that tears flowing freely from the deep well of the soul bring cleansing and lead to the fresh waters of life. Tears come from deep within us to cleanse, to purge, and to open the way for the fresh waters of life, living waters of faith. And faith is a tool that brings healing. God has promised to be with us. In fact, God has come to be near us in His Son, Jesus. It's faith in Jesus, His life-saving death and resurrection, that gave Kenny hope and that gives us hope. And we are told that God loved us enough to give His Son for us, that in believing we might have life, life in His name. And so this is the time to look to faith, to rededicate ourselves to the duty, our duty to God and to each other, so that we might grow in claiming the promises of God for all those who believe in His Son. Finally, the last tool that we have is God's promise that nothing will separate us from the love of Christ. Not hardship, not distress, not even death. Not one thing, no matter what. God promises to be with us and to hold us, even in death, in His loving arms. He holds Kenny there now, and He holds us too, until that time when we are reunited. And in that, we can be sure. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I would invite you to have an experience to page 282 in your hymnals and join with me confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to death. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the
the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, give courage and faith to all who mourn, and assure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your life and life. Lord, in your mercy, help us, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, and the resurrection to life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy, God of all grace, we give you thanks, because by his death our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Stand.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Dan,
I just realized
that
I was so into thinking about other things. I had to skip ahead. So, Loretta, if you're ready, we will sing hymn 742, What a Friend We Have with Jesus, and we'll just do a double feature and go right into honor and rejoicing after that. 742.
Thank you.
In 537, on our way, rejoice. Let us commend Kenny to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Kenny. Acknowledge we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, and into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in life. Amen. Let us go forth in peace.
Smoky in here?
Maybe a little bit.
Huh.